morning, everyone. We'd just like to start off with prayer before we get going. So in Jesus' name, we just come to you, Lord. We just ask for your gracious Holy Spirit to be here. Ask you for your guidance in your direction, Lord, and what you'd have me to say today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Just guys, tell you guys a little bit about what's going on here today. Lord likes to do to Pastor Mark at different times. I've been studying for the last 3 or 4 days and had a good part of things I wanted to speak about. And last night I was trying to get them all written down and nothing was coming. So this morning I got up early and I was going to write everything down and nothing would come. I started singing and praising God and just asked him for his guidance on what he'd have me speak about today. And in his infinite wisdom, he decided to totally change everything that I'd studied and what I wanted to talk about. So today, I'm just following his lead. But I would like to start off with probably about a minute and a half, 2 minutes of a song that I have. I would like to sing. You're more than welcome to sing with me. They're just the choruses of a couple songs, but I believe the Lord wanted me to start this off today with a little praise and a little worship, besides just the word, and then we'll get to the word.
So small when we see Christ, a glimpse of his dear face, all sorrows will erase. Oh, pray we run the race
God spoke to me about this morning was that, like the song said, we need to surrender all, that everything that we do needs to stem from the Lord and from the Holy Spirit, that needs to be our direction, our director, that, you know, it says in the Bible that through our weakness that he is made strong. It is all his power in his glory, in his might, that gives us the power to witness to people, to call people to God, that it's not, nothing comes from us. We are nothing without him. We're nothing without the Holy Spirit guiding our lives. In John 6:63, Jesus said, "It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak to you are spirit. They are life." I mean, this is Jesus himself saying that basically everything comes from the Spirit, that the Spirit is our life. This is what we are supposed to be earnestly seeking, asking for, that we are to be led. In 2 Corinthians 3:17 says, "Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty." There's liberty to freedom when the Spirit comes on you to lose your will, to lose what you want to do and to follow him. John in 1 Corinthians 2:4-5 says, "And my speech and my preaching were not persuasive words of human wisdom, but a demonstration of the Spirit and power, that your faith should be in the wisdom, or should not be in the wisdom of man, but in the power of God." We are not to rely on anything that comes from us. You know, back in Genesis, Adam and Eve sinned. And the Bible repeatedly tells us that our spirit is prone to evil. You know, so we can't rely on our spirit and on our soul. We need to rely on the words of God, the wisdom of God, the Holy Spirit leading our lives. When Jesus was baptized, on Mark 1:10, it says, "And immediately Jesus came up from the water. He saw the heavens parting and the Spirit descending upon like a dove." In that scripture, parting, the word actually means torn out of heaven. The heavens were torn. To me, that just, I had to resonate on that for a while to fully understand, but when you're talking about the heavens being torn, that means that is a new beginning, that something that we knew as an old before that point in time had been changed. The heavens were ripped open. God gave Jesus an unmeasurable amount of the Holy Spirit. With that Spirit, you know, in the Bible it says over and over again that we're to be rivers of living water. And by that it means that a river is an unlimited supply. When it passes you, there's still water coming. We can never use the full amount. We can never have the full amount. We are to strive for that like Jesus had. You know, Jesus had such an anointing on his life with that unlimited measure that he had on him, that people, they longed just to be in his presence. People would do miraculous things. You know, they would climb trees. They would crawl through just to touch the hem of his garment to be healed, just to be in his presence, to be in the anointing of the Lord God Almighty himself. You know, it's what they want. It says that we are to long for that we should have an unlimited supply of anointing on our lives, that's what we should be asking for, that we should be demonstrations of his power and might on this earth also, that people should long to be around us to see what makes us special. And that special is the Holy Spirit in us, that they're longing to see what that is. This is what draws people to church. If there's an unlimited supply of the Holy Spirit in this church and people are being slain in the Spirit and being healed and there's words spoken, the word gets out and people want to come. They want to see the excitement. You know, that's what Jesus had. This is what we should be longing for in this church, is the Holy Spirit in unlimited supply to just guide our lives. You know, we can witness to people all we want, but 90%, probably 98% of the time, we don't have our Bible with us. We need the Holy Spirit in us to guide us, to give us the scriptures. We've read the scriptures, but he brings them out of us. He gives us knowledge and wisdom on how to use them at the right times. And this is what we need in our lives, that we need him. We need him more than ever in these times, that the way the world is going, to be a light to people. You know, in Acts, it speaks of the day of Pentecost. And that was the first time that basically Jesus had left, was crucified, was resurrected, that the Holy Spirit came, the gift that he was talking about came to the people. It came in a mighty rushing wind. It was a demonstration of power and might that was in Acts. And that was our signal that as Jesus, when he was baptized and the heavens parted, that was our signal that we are to be an unlimited supply of the Holy Spirit, that he is supposed to be on us the same way that he was Jesus. It says that we are to do greater things than Jesus did. How can we do that if we don't have the Holy Spirit guiding us and leading us? That is the only way that we can do anything. I can do nothing through myself. In 2 Corinthians 4:7, it says, but we have this treasure in earthen vessels, and that is us, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. You know, these vessels, they are us. We are earthen vessels. That's what Jesus was. He made himself an earthen vessel to come down here to show us what is possible on this earth. When the scripture says that it shall be done on earth as it is in heaven. And that's what the heavens parting and the Holy Spirit came down was opening up. It was opening up this new realm that we can be here on earth with the same power, the same dominion, the same right, the authority that Jesus had in heaven, that we can have that here, and that we are supposed to have it, and we are supposed to use it. We are supposed to show it off, this demonstration that God gives us. The Spirit, I just want to briefly talk, not get into great depth on this, but the Spirit of God, it says that on God's throne, that basically there are seven fires, seven spirits on each side of the throne. And these are the seven spirits of God. You know, these seven spirits in Isaiah 11:2 says, the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and of might, the Spirit of knowledge, basically of God, and fear of the Lord. That these are the seven spirits. These are the seven characteristics of the Holy Spirit. This is what we are to yearn for, not just the gifts of the Spirit, but we are to pray and ask for God to give us the seven spirits of the Holy Spirit to lead our lives. You know, these all have their own purposes and God uses them in their own ways. But these are just the characteristics of the Holy Spirit. And the last three or four days, when we had all the thunderstorms, I'd read this verse and I just could not help but marvel and see God's mighty hand and work at the thunderstorms. We've had all these fires. There's been thousands of people praying that we have rain, that these fires are helped put out. And it seemed like there was nothing coming. And then all of a sudden, thunderstorms come in. In Revelation 4:5, it says, and from the throne proceeded lightnings, thunderings, and voices, seven lamps of fire. There again are the seven lamps. We're burning before the throne. When are the seven spirits of God? So, you know, just talking about the seven spirits again, but when those thunder started, I felt the Holy Spirit on me and saying, I hear your prayers. I hear the people of God crying out. I hear your prayers. Here's a mighty rain coming your way. It may not totally put the fires out, but it is definitely dampening them. If it hit them, you know, it put a damper on those. And he was just, I believe, in his own way, showing you that he is still in charge. He's still Lord of Lords and King of Kings, and then he can do anything he wants, but that we do need to humble ourselves. You know, we need to seek the Lord. We need to ask him for guidance. We need to ask for forgiveness for the sins of this country, you know. But we cannot witness to these people that are not saved if we don't have the Holy Spirit in us. It says that nobody is brought to the Lord unless it is by the Holy Spirit, by the unction of the Holy Spirit. And we need the Holy Spirit to be able to help us in these times. We are called as warriors and saints of Christ to spread his word, to bring people to the Lord. That is, most importantly, our main mission here on this earth is not just to live a godly life, a holy, righteous life, but we are to bring the unsaved, that we are to graft them into the tree of Jesus, that this flow of the sap of this tree, that this is the Holy Spirit, this is the unending supply of the Holy Spirit that we need to impart on people, and that we need to give them what we have. When God told me to change my what I was going to talk about this morning, approximately a week ago, I was watching this young lady, and she was preaching over in Africa. She was an African, and she was in her early 20s, and she felt a calling on her life, and she was supposed to go preach, teach at this village, and she had nothing. She had nothing, and God said, he told her basically the same thing he told me, and that's what he was showing me, that it is not you. You don't have to have anything. That he's showing me to rely on him, to have faith, to trust in him, to believe in him, and to trust his will. That he sends us out into the world sometimes totally unprepared, because we are supposed to rely on him. We're supposed to rely on his spirit and his strength. And if we cannot do that, we're showing lack of faith and trust in him, that we don't think that he can do what he says he can do when he says that he will send us out and that we will be fishers of men, that we need to be fishers of men. And in order to do that, we need to trust him, whether the circumstances seem like you're prepared, you're good enough, your speech is eloquent enough, all these different things, that we need to do this. That's about all that the Lord had for me today. It was just to impress on you guys to trust in him, trust in his power, to remind you that no strength of our own does us any good, that we have no strength, that we must rely on him, that he is the giver of all gifts, and he gives us these gifts to be used. We are not to hide them. We are not to keep them for ourselves. We are to use the gifts of the Holy Spirit to bless people, to show his God's grace and his mercy, and to show his power, and to give him glory. If we are not giving him glory, we are not doing our job here. That we need to give God glory, that people see him in us. And that's all I have. Thank you.